Good morning. It is wonderful to have you with us here on July 5th, 2020. Welcome to our virtual service at Sherwood Episcopal Church in Coptiesville, Maryland. My name is the Reverend Nancy Hennessey, and I'm the rector here, and I welcome you. Just a few announcements before we begin our service. I don't know, but once again, we have some gorgeous flowers from Kimberly's farm. I will be delivering them some flowers, bouquets to two of our members of our congregation. And if you're interested in getting some of these beautiful, fresh cut flowers on Sunday afternoon, I will be more than happy to deliver them to you. You do need to be home because I'm just going to drop them off on your porch. But these are just too beautiful not to share with everyone. So I hope you take me up on that offer. Just a few things. Our Bible 101 will be beginning this Wednesday. There needs to be a correction to the time. We will begin at 12 and end at 1:15. So my apologies for that because it was incorrect in the bulletin. But I'm looking forward to it. We have a good group that will join us, and we will meet for just two Wednesdays, and then we have something planned later on in July. Also, the questionnaire. We have two questionnaires that we have put together, the staff, and these are questions about reopening and the possibly, or not reopening because we have always been open, but regathering in person. We want to hear from you. The COVID-19 task force and the vestry will be looking at this come the beginning of August and assessing everything, but until then, we are sort of gathering information so that we have a better idea of where you stand in regards to possibly coming back on a limited basis in a much different way, with no music, everyone in masks, people scattered about and 6 feet in distance, but there may be some opportunities for that. But we want to hear from you. So please fill out that questionnaire. Don't do it as a family, do it individually, because some members of the family may have different viewpoints. So please, if you as a couple, please fill it out individually. And other things, we will be having our annual meeting or our mid-year annual meeting. If you recall, we were scheduled to have it at the end of March, and things changed with COVID-19. So we will be having it on August 19th. It'll be following the service, and we will do it via Zoom, which means if you have a phone or if you have a computer with it or a cell phone, you can participate, whether you are actually being videotaped and seen or just on the phone. So everyone should be able to take advantage of that, and we'll work with everyone in regards to how to go about all of that. And I think that is about it. There is some wonderful volunteer opportunities. We'll be doing another loaves and fishes opportunity. And also our friends at Epiphany Community Center are looking for some help on Tuesday, July 7th from 4 to 6. Everything is in the bulletin, which you can find at sherwoodcockeysville.org, our website. And the bulletin, you can download it for the service now. And what we typically do is have a few moments of silence so we can gather our thoughts. We can open our hearts and our minds to hearing God's words through scripture, through hymnal, through the beautiful sermon that we will have with Anne here today, who will be sharing her Lenten journey. I still feel we're in Lent, and she's still on the journey, so it'll be exciting to hear from her. So in a few moments, we will begin our service. Thank you. We appear to have a technical difficulty, so we will be with you in a moment. Cool. Let us begin our service. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. And now let us sing our first hymn from Lift Every Voice and Sing, hymn 599, verses 1, 2, and 3. Let us pray. O God, you grace of your Holy Spirit, that we may be devoted to you with our whole heart and united to one another with pure affection. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
And now for our first reading.
The first reading is from the book of Genesis. The servant said to Laban, "I am Abraham's servant. The Lord has greatly blessed my master, and he has become wealthy. He has given him flocks and herds, silver and gold, male and female slaves, camels and donkeys. And Sarah, my master's wife, bore a son to my master when he was old, and he has given him all that he has. My master made me swear, saying, 'You shall not take a wife for my son from the daughter of the Canaanites, in whose land I live. But you shall go to my father's house, to my kindred, and get a wife for my son.' I came today to the spring and said, 'O Lord, the God of my master Abraham, if now you will only make successful the way I am going, I am standing here by the spring of water. Let the young woman who comes out to draw, to whom I shall say, "Please give me a little water from your jar to drink," and who will say to me, "Drink, and I will draw for your camels also," let her be the woman whom the Lord has appointed for my master's son." Before I finished speaking in my heart, there was Rebekah coming out with her water jar on her shoulder. And she went down to the spring and drew. I said to her, "Please let me drink." She quickly let down her jar from her shoulder and said, "Drink, and I will also water your camels." So I drank, and she also watered the camels. Then I asked her, "Whose daughter are you?" She said, "The daughter of Bethuel, Nahor's son, whom Milcah bore to him." So I put the ring on her nose and the bracelets on her arms. Then I bowed my head and worshipped the Lord, and blessed the Lord, the God of my master Abraham, who had led me by the right way to obtain the daughter of my master's kinsman for his son. Now then, if you will deal loyally and truly with my master, tell me. And if not, tell me, so that I may turn either to the right hand or to the left." And they called Rebekah and said to her, "Will you go with this man?" She said, "I will." So they went away. They sent away their sister Rebekah and her nurse, along with Abraham's servant and his men. And they blessed Rebekah and said to her, "May you, our sister, become thousands of myriads. May your offspring gain possession of the gates of their foes." Then Rebekah and her maids rose up, mounted the camels, and followed the men. Thus the servant took Rebekah and went his way. Now Isaac had come from Beer Lahai-Roi and was settled in the Negev. Isaac went out in the evening to walk in the field, and looking up, he saw camels coming. And Rebekah looked up, and when she saw Isaac, she slipped quickly from the camel and said to the servant, "Who is the man over there walking in the field to meet us?" The servant said, "It is my master." So she took her veil and covered herself, and the servant told Isaac all the things that he had done. Then Isaac brought her into his mother Sarah's tent. He took Rebekah, and she became his wife, and he loved her. So Isaac was comforted after his mother's death. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm appointed for today is Psalm 45, verses 11 through 18. We will read in unison. "Hear, O daughter, consider and listen closely. Forget your people and your father's house. The king will have pleasure in your beauty. He is your master, therefore do him honor. The people of Tyre are here with a gift. The rich among the people seek your favor. All glorious is the princess as she enters. Her gown is cloth of gold. In embroidered apparel, she is brought to the king. After her, the bridesmaids follow in procession. With joy and gladness they are brought, and enter into the palace of the king. In place of fathers, O king, you shall have sons. You shall make them princes over all the earth. I will make your name to be remembered from one generation to another. Therefore, nations will praise you forever and ever.
May this week be filled with us reaching out in love and not hate. May this week turn the world to God's loving arms. Amen. Good morning. The Gospel from Matthew this morning asks a question that certainly seems relevant to this time we are living in. Jesus said to the crowd, "To what will I compare this generation? To what will I compare this generation?" In order for me to tell you what I believe, I first must tell you what brought me here today to share my story. As many of my friends here at Sherwood know, the season of Lent has become special to me. As a time of reflection and penance, I have purposely tried to pay attention and be in the Spirit. Last year, I took on a task of calling an individual every day during Lent that had come through my life at some point. It was an eye-opening experience, to say the least. This year, I had struggled to come up with something that would be as meaningful as that was. After much thought and reflection, I decided I was going to focus on three very specific questions that are in the Episcopal Baptismal Covenant. I chose the following: proclaim by word and example the good news of God in Christ. Seek and serve Christ in all persons, loving your neighbor as yourself. Strive for justice and peace among all people, and respect the dignity of every human being. Ash Wednesday was on February 26th this year. Ralph and I had left that morning for a week of sun and relaxation in Southwest Florida. I had written down some thoughts of what I might do to try and live out the covenants. For example, I was going to volunteer at the animal shelter, visit someone in the hospital, make up a caring bag for the needy or the homeless, call someone I struggle with, offer encouragement to a friend who might be struggling, and last but certainly not least, forgiving and asking for forgiveness. My Lenten journey began that day with a bang. While in the airport, after going through the long process of checking in, security checkpoints, walking forever to the gate, I sat down and realized I had left my iPad in the restroom at the entrance of the airport. I made my way all the way back, only to find it gone. I checked with security, and they sent me to another area of the airport where the lost and found was. Deflated that my vacation was starting off like this, I began my journey back when I saw an airport security person carrying my iPad. I stopped her and told her I thought it was mine. She asked me for my ID, and when I showed her I could unlock it, she gave it to me. I was so grateful. That evening, I purposely took the time to write the head of security at BWI Marshall to thank them and recognize the individual who was taking it to the lost and found. I received a note back from them for recognizing what they do. Even though this was a very small gesture, I wanted this to be an example of just how doing one small thing can make a difference. The first day of my Lenten journey was in the books. While in Florida, the news was carrying the COVID-19 updates. Within just a few weeks, life as we knew it began to change. Businesses were forced to close, churches could not hold services in person, support groups couldn't meet, grocery shelves were empty. People suddenly had lost their jobs or were furloughed indefinitely. Life was turned upside down. What was happening? Clearly, my plan for my Lenten journey didn't materialize the way that I thought it would. What would I do? I didn't want to let go of focusing on my baptismal covenant. One place that continued to be a strength for me was being a member here at Sherwood, and not only having a wonderful rector and Mother Nancy Hennessy, but the support of the Episcopal Diocese and our friends here at church. Holy Week services was brought to us via Facebook Live from the home of Mother Nancy. It was different, but thanks to technology, we were still able to have a Palm Sunday service, foot washing on Holy Thursday, a sacred Good Friday service, and a joyous Easter service overlooking beautiful Frederick County from the porch of Mother Nancy's home. Watching each service from my home, I would share this service with my friends via Facebook in real time. I was amazed at how many friends joined in with me to listen and hear the Word of God. I realized how resilient we human beings can really be. Social distancing became the norm. One thing that was very hard for everyone was not having the physical connection to our family and friends. Most notably, the people who may not have capability or accessibility to the internet. Those living in retirement homes where they became virtual prisoners in their homes just to keep them safe. Mother Nancy coordinated a group of four of us that would reach out weekly to call all members of our church.
Each week, we would rotate the people we called. This gave us an opportunity to be sure everyone was touched in one way or another with a phone call, an email, or a text message. Much like last year during Lent, when I thought I'd give something to individuals by calling them, I have gotten back so much more with the phone tree calls. I have made new friends. I say this because having the time to speak with people one-on-one is different from having a minute to chat after church or at coffee hour. I've learned so much about people and shared in their stories, learning about their lives and past. I looked forward to doing this each week. Indeed, I have seen Christ in all persons. I find it almost funny that when I chose the last covenant about striving for justice and peace among all people, I wasn't sure how I was going to do this. Like everything else, it was thrust in my face, and here was God saying, "Here you go, Anne, have at it." As many of you know, I have been running for the last 16 years. I started running when I was 50 years old and continue to run today. Albeit slower, but I still run. This is something that I love to do. I have made lasting friendships in the running community. I love that I have friends that I never would have met had it not been for running. We all have such diverse backgrounds and lifestyles, but come together as a running community. In May of this year, the running community across the U.S. suffered a devastating blow when a fellow runner named Ahmaud Arbery was murdered while running. Even sadder is the fact that this happened on February 23rd, and it took over 2 months of this young man's family working tirelessly to bring justice. When I saw the news, it made me sick. Here was a young black man running, and two white men, father and son, taking the law into their own hands because they thought he was a suspect in a recent robbery. My eyes weren't fully opened yet, though. Valencia Hype is a beautiful young woman I have met through the running community. She is currently president of the Baltimore Roadrunners Club. She posted a comment on Facebook that will forever change the way I see people. On May 8th, she wrote, and I quote, "How sad is it that we cannot run in our own neighborhoods without the fear of being killed just because of our skin color?" Until that moment, I realized that I have never seen color in my running friends. I never even thought about it. Why would I? As a woman, and I'm guessing most women at some point in their lives have felt vulnerable or fearful in certain situations, whether walking to a parked car, hiking on a trail alone, or just not sure of their surroundings, we have become scared or frightened. I can assure you, I have never been afraid because of the color of my skin. This was so upsetting to me that I didn't say anything to anyone, not even Ralph, about this. It was about 10 days later, I reached out to Mother Nancy to talk about it. By this time, my emotions had gone from being sad and upset to being angry. What was it this time that finally struck a chord? How could this happen to someone that was just running? This is something I take for granted all the time. It was then that I asked Mother Nancy if I could tell my Lenten journey story, because this was a baptismal covenant looking me straight in my face. Strive for justice and peace among all people, and respect the dignity of every human being. No parent should ever have to fight for their child's murder to be brought to justice, no matter the color of their skin. And when I thought it couldn't get any worse, George Floyd is slowly murdered on video by an individual who is paid to protect people, taking 8 minutes and 46 seconds to die. I'm not sure why these two events have finally made many of us stand up and not only take notice, but to be the change.
Was it because many of us have been quarantined and now we take the time to see what's happening? I've heard it said, how could others just stand around and watch this happen? Fear is a powerful emotion. All we have to do is look at the Bible and the actions of Holy Week. Christ told Peter he would deny him 3 times. Peter says that would never happen, but it did. We're living in such a frightening time. Everyone around the world is dealing with a virus with no end in sight. Horrible violence occurring, using the injustices that have happened for years as an excuse to riot. Racism in many forms. The list goes on and on. So where does this bring me? In early February of this year, I attended a reparations workshop put on by the Episcopal Diocese of Maryland in Ellicott City. Now, some people might say, I don't want to hear about reparations, but we do need to hear, and we need to listen. It was an eye-opening experience for me, listening to both white and people of color express their views. I am so glad I went. Choosing the baptismal covenant for my Lenten journey, only to have Bishop Sutton make this covenant a point during all of these crises, has put me on the right track to do something. For me personally, I would like to say I'm sorry to my friends of color, especially my running friends, Valencia, Monique, TJ, Penny, Hazel, Tamlin, Deborah, and so many others. I'm sorry it's taken me 66 years. I will stand with you and be your voice when you are unable. I will not let you down. Ralph and I became members of the United States Holocaust Museum recently, another deep racist tragedy that has occurred in our lifetime. We continue to work with a local church helping to supply food for the homeless and marginalized. I have signed up for races where the money that's raised will benefit those most in need. I will listen and ask to be heard when necessary. I am learning not to put a color to a person's name when speaking, just because their skin is not the same color as mine. And most important, I will make every effort to be the person in our baptismal covenant. We cannot go back and change what has happened, but we can be the difference going forward. We need to be like nature. In spring each year, new leaves appear as they experience new growth. We too can grow in our understanding and actions. Ralph always used to say when he had his business, your toughest customers become your best customers. They make you work harder to be better. We need to work harder and see the world through all of our eyes. We can all heal through God's grace. It starts with each of us. We need to forgive, and we need forgiving. As Matthew's gospel says today, to what will I compare this generation? The gospel ends with, come to me, all you that are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Let us be the generation that makes the difference. Let us see the world through the eyes of children, without prejudice and without color. We have the chance to embrace personal growth amid all of this conflict. Let us strive for justice and peace among all people, and respect the dignity of every human being. As I said before, my friends, I leave you with the following. Live in such a way that those who don't know God will come to know him because they know you. Amen.
Thank you.
eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. And now for the prayers of the people. Let us come before God in a posture of openness, expecting the Holy Spirit to transform our lives and to lead us into the offering of our prayers as we respond, "Hear us, Lord. Free us from the bondage of our sinful ways, our blindness to truth, our stubbornness and lack of discipline, that we may yearn after the fruits of divine word and follow its wisdom. Let us pray. Hear us, Lord. Strengthen the love and devotion amongst family members, that forgiveness may heal old wounds and mutual affection pave the way to wholeness. Let us pray. Hear us, Lord. Guide the leaders of our church, diocese, and congregation, that there may be mutual respect across and a renewed sense of partnership in bringing God's kingdom into the most troubled corners of our neighbors and nations. Let us pray. Hear us, Lord. Encourage our civic leaders to modify their convictions with compromise, that there may be renewal of hope for those who live in poverty, unemployment, and the lack of education opportunities. Let us pray. Hear us, Lord. Reveal the unfolding beauty of creation, the uniqueness of seasons, and the joy and wonder of your handicraft, that we may delight in guarding these gifts. Let us pray. Hear us, Lord. Hold in your arms of mercy for the ill, poor, hungry, oppressed, and those impacted by COVID-19. We ask for your prayers, especially for those on our parish prayer list: Sally, Avery, Derek, Lorraine, Debbie, Elizabeth, Shannon, Jeff and Kim, Norma, Sharon, Mary Rose, Margaret, Ed, Laura, Steve, Joyce, Haley, Paul, Christine, Richard, Mike and his family, Kendall, Teresa, Jean, Marge, Sarah, Becky, Joe, the Smith family, David, Ralph, Gail, Suzanne, the Frost family, Margaret, Ruth Ann, Mark, the Jackson family, Mary Lou, and Charles. Let us pray. Hear us, Lord. We thank you for the blessings of this life, especially for those celebrating birthdays. Hear us, Lord. And gracious God, give to the departed eternal rest, and in your loving arms remember Carol. Let us pray to the Lord. Hear us, Lord. O Lord, our God, accept the fervent prayers of your people and the multitude of your mercies. Look with compassion upon us and all who turn to you for help. For you are gracious, O lover of souls, and to you we give glory. glory, our Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer. Amen. And now let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. And now the peace of the Lord be always with you, and also with you. Let us greet one another virtually, and those who are here, peace.
God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. And now let us sing hymn 5.